Welcome to Pivot Points, a new series featuring some of the world's most successful women, candidly sharing their stories and insights about how they made it to the top and how you can too. Hosted by Perry Yeatman, a straight-talking global executive and award-winning author who created the career and life of her dreams and now wants to help other ambitious women do the same.
Welcome. I'm Perry Yeatman, host of Pivot Points. And today, my guest is Rhonda Jordan. Rhonda is a 25-year veteran of Kraft Foods, which is not surprisingly where we met. During her career there, she rose to the level of unit president. She was the president of cheese. She was the president of grocery and of frozen pizza, all very important parts of Kraft Foods. In those roles, she was ultimately responsible for virtually every function in the company: sales, finance, operations, R&D, logistics, strategy. She oversaw all of those within those divisions. Today, she serves on the board of directors of Colfax Corporation, Ingredion, and Busch Brothers. Rhonda, I'm so glad you could be with us today. Thank you so much. Welcome.
Well, thank you, Perry. Glad to be here.
So at some point, I mean, I know you started in the marketing function at Kraft, and you were able to work your way all the way to the top. But the question I have is, how did you land that first job?
Well, my first job at Kraft was an assignment I got directly out of business school. So I had worked for 5 years right out of college, and I decided to go back to graduate business school at Kellogg. And then, having gone through the interview process at Kellogg, I found my job at Kraft and lived happily ever after.
So if you really want, one path is pick a great business school like Kellogg and interview well on the way out. So there you go. In the mid-career period, that's really when a lot of women feel the kind of tug and stress and strain of what I think of as caregiving. So today that might be about aging parents, but it's also about kids, particularly younger children. And so I'm curious about how you made it work. And did you ever feel like throwing in the towel, just saying enough?
Absolutely, I did. And I would say there was a period of time when my sons were probably preschool to early grade school, and I seemed to be regularly questioning whether I should stop working so I could spend more time with them or whether I should work part-time instead of full-time. So over what was probably a couple of years, I would go back and forth evaluating different alternatives. And it probably goes without saying that this was not something I discussed openly at work, but I was very fortunate to have a close friend I could confide in who understood my situation, and she was also a working mom with two youngish children. Finally, during one of our conversations, when I once again brought up my debate about leaving my job or working part-time, my friend turned to me and said, "Rhonda, you need to stop talking about this. You love your job, your boys are fine, and you're not going to quit or change what you're doing. So stop thinking about it." And just like that, I realized she was right. I mean, it was almost instantaneous. I did love what I was doing, and things were fine with our sons. And from that point on, I never looked back. I stopped thinking of myself as someone who might stop working, and instead, I thought of myself as someone who worked full-time and loved it.
You know, that is such an important story and lesson for everybody, because I think that one of the things that we really struggle with is the guilt. Right? Many of us are lucky that we actually have good support systems. We can afford good childcare. We can afford to have nannies or whatever the right answer is for our family or a stay-at-home spouse. But it doesn't get rid of the guilt. And until you can put down the guilt, then you're never really comfortable with that choice.
Right. You know, I'm sharing that example because I don't think there's a working mom I know who hasn't gone through that sort of agonizing decision process of what's best for me and my family. And I want to mention one thing that I think people should keep in mind. Often that debate, whether it's internal or external, happens at a time when your children are young and you're just physically exhausted, or maybe you're not exhausted, but you hit a particularly difficult time in your career, and it just seems like all the effort and juggling may not be worth it. I can't tell you what the right answer is, because for everybody it's something different, but it is very normal to go through times like this. And the one thing I would suggest is that you try not to make a decision when you're at a low point. things always tend to get better, and I think you make better decisions when you can evaluate the pros and cons of your career options when they're not colored by a really challenging time, whether it's personal or professional.
That is just excellent advice. And I couldn't agree more, actually, because I think that what happens is in the moment, it feels like it's going to be the right idea. But what we find is there are a lot of women who step out and who then end up regretting it. Just a year later, even, they end up regretting it. And I think that's just really a shame. So it might be the right decision for some women. I'm not saying that there's never a case where that is the right decision. But I think that you're right. I think you need to be very thoughtful and you need to think about the long term. I mean, you know, what are the implications of a decision that you make today for the long term trajectory of your career and whatever it is you really want to achieve with your life?
Right.
That's great advice. So obviously, you know, as I said in the intro, you had a lot of different jobs at Kraft. And each one of those is in and of itself a transition. Even though you were at the same employer, you know, you went through different functions. You probably went through some different geographies. You definitely went through different categories and different roles. How did you ultimately negotiate for what you really wanted to make those transitions work, both for you and for the company?
Well, I'm going to share a very early example of something that happened to me, or I made happen to me early in my career, and it gave me the confidence to do that again and again. But when I first started at Kraft, I was a brand assistant. That was the title for an entry-level marketing position. And at the time, one of the capabilities that was recognized as something you needed to prove was analytics. So I knew early on that to do well in my job and to advance, I needed to prove I had analytic chops. And yet, when I looked across my assignments, I felt I wasn't being given enough analytic assignments to do that. So, you know, I agonized over it. I had only been there a couple of months, but I went to my brand manager and I said, I think I need to do more analytics. And he said, okay, well, we have a business problem. Figure it out and go solve it. So, and it wasn't quite that simple. He helped lay out what, you know, exactly I was going to be doing. But I started digging into a fairly important issue for the brand. I showed what was happening, what we could do about it, and my work was well received, and I ended up giving the presentation not just to my manager, but to my manager's manager, and then ultimately to the president of the division, which was pretty unusual for a brand assistant. So the presentation went well, and I ended up not only enhancing a valuable capability, the analytics side, but I also got an experience that helped set me apart early on in my career. And what was important about that is I learned early on, ask. If there's something you think you need or you want to keep developing, you need to ask for it. And I think, you know, a lot of us are very fortunate to work in companies that have wonderful development programs. And, you know, the company's best intentions are to develop and to grow their employees. But nobody has a better interest in your career than you do. So it's important to remember that you need to be the one advocating for things you want. But it's also important to remember that from your employer's perspective, it's not just about you. It's ultimately about the work you do and the value you add to the organization. So I think keeping in mind that you need to ask for things if you really see something that you think is important to your career, but you also need to put it into the context of what it does for the company or the organization.
You know, as you know me, I'm a pretty outspoken woman, and my daughter has turned out to be exactly like that. So I sometimes struggle to imagine how it is in life that you don't really just raise your hand for every answer in the classroom or for every assignment that sounds like out there and wacky. And just like, you know, everybody says, oh, nobody could do that. That was like the first assignment I always raised my hand for because I just wanted to prove, man, if nobody else could do it, I was gonna do it. So this was not a problem that I personally really struggled with, but it is a problem for so many of the women in the workforce. And so, you know, I know that you are a little bit, certainly more shy than I am. You're not a shy person, but you are a bit more reserved than I am because, of course, 95% of the population probably is. But how did you get up the guts to do that ask the first time? Like, what was it you were thinking? Did you like look in the mirror and have to like prep yourself, or how did you get the guts to do that?
That's a really good question. And I think I looked at the alternative. I could say nothing and sort of stew over it and wonder if I am getting all the experience I need, or I could say something. And I came back to that principle throughout my career. There were times when, you know, I wondered about a certain job that might be coming open that I really was interested in. And I would do a little bit of hand-wringing and say, well, should I say something? Should I not? And it was never a long process because I looked at it and said, what's the downside of saying something? Very little. No one is ever going to fault you for saying, gee, I'd like to do more, or I'd like to do something that builds a new capability that can help the company. The flip side is if you say nothing, you have nobody to blame for yourself.
Yeah, I completely agree. And your other comment about how we are the masters of our own destiny, I think it's very true. Of course, you need help and mentors and sponsors and, you know, luck. But you are ultimately the person who is responsible for making it happen for yourself. So I think that's really important.
And don't fall into the trap of assuming the company knows what's best and they have developed hundreds of people or thousands or whatever. And, you know, they'll do what's right for me. They will try, but they don't know you personally. So you need to take ownership of that.
Agreed. Nobody can know what you want at a certain point in your life better than you. And so you've got to go for it. So obviously, as I said, you made it to the top. You were president of several different divisions, which are multi-billion dollar businesses in a company the size of Kraft. Recent research has made very clear that it just sucks for us, but it's just the fact based on research that...
Vera, you need to be more direct.
Yeah. I'm working on it. That's one of my development opportunities. So as you move up, men get more liked. Even men that frankly are not really likable become more liked as they move up and succeed. And women suffer the opposite. They actually become less liked overall as they move up. So was there ever a time when you had to choose between kind of like and respect? And how did you deal with that?
You know, for me, the end goal was always about doing the job I was hired to do. And honestly, and maybe I had my head in the sand, I really didn't think about whether I was respected or liked. I think those are outcomes along the way rather than something you consciously choose to cultivate. Said another way, if you're focused on doing the best job possible, whether you're driving shareholder value or you're creating growth or developing a new product, whatever it is, you'll earn people's respect if you do a good job in whatever it is you were hired to accomplish. And then the how that you do that job. So there's the what, which is the job you do, and then the how you do it in terms of working with and leading your team or developing people or treating people with respect, earning their trust. That how translates often to being liked as well as respected. So that's not to say there won't be times when you have to make tough calls, and doing your job certainly won't help you win a popularity contest. But in my mind, that was never the goal. The goal was doing my job well and then being respected or liked, or both ended up, you know, hopefully being an incremental benefit.
You know, there's another topic, and I just have to put it out there because it's also something that we at the, you know, women at the top have to deal with, and actually women all the way up have to deal with, and that is the intense scrutiny. We are clearly more scrutinized than our male peers in a lot of different ways. You know, recently the Wall Street Journal had an article about how women CEOs are exponentially more likely to be targeted by activist investors. Thanks a lot. But it's not just on performance, because that seems at least somewhat fair. It's actually on everything from looks to parenting. You know, if a guy CEO, if a male CEO takes time out to be, or doesn't take time out to be a parent, nobody's commenting on that. If a man does take time out to be a parent, maybe that's the reverse. So they do have some bias. It's the opposite. But for women, it seems that, you know, kind of everything is fair game. So we are just living under this microscope constantly. How did you handle that? Did you have like kind of a go-to uniform or look that let you kind of just manage it and get on with your day?
Well, I think I recognized early on that leaders were going to be scrutinized, because I remember the cafeteria conversations I would have with peers, and we would literally talk about all the senior leaders, both men and women. So when you do that enough, you realize that once you're sitting in those same chairs of those leaders, people are doing that about you. So it never surprised me to think that people would be scrutinizing you as a leader. But I think what it comes down to is if you have a very strong sense of yourself, of what you're trying to accomplish, you know, of what you're doing, then you're less likely to get distracted by people who are second-guessing your choices. Whether those choices are professional or personal, if you have in mind, this is what I'm focused on doing and this is what I'm all about, I don't know that you will get distracted by that. You shouldn't, because it's a total waste of time. It's going to happen, and there's nothing you can do about it. So you need to learn to live with it.
I agree. In fact, you know, one of the things I hope that our listeners take from these podcasts is that a lot of the hottest topics today actually are things where when you listen to women who have made it, what they're all kind of saying is, it's all going to come back to performance. And you just need to be able to be tough enough and confident enough and know who you are to not let all of the distractions of things that are out there take you off course.
Right.
And I think it's hard because, you know, a lot of us want to fight for fairness. Why is it fair that, you know, women have to deal with sexual harassment? Why is it fair that women are more scrutinized on their looks? I think you said it really well earlier in this interview. As long as you keep focusing on the why is it not fair and whatever, the truth is you're missing the point, and it gets you all riled up about some of the wrong answers. Now, I'm not saying that I am at all tolerant of sexual harassment in the workplace or, you know, any of these things. I don't agree with them, and I would love to be able to stamp them out. But I also think that there has to be a pragmatic side to there are certain things you just ignore and move on and don't worry about. And then, you know, obviously, if they cross the line, then you have to take a different action.
Right.
But I do think that's it's really important. We often hear that it's lonely at the top. When you are the head of something, you know, the buck really does stop with you. You have a team and, you know, everybody's in there together. And if you're working in a good company and you're lucky, you have a team that's highly supportive, like we often did at Kraft. But the buck does stop with the leader. And it's even more lonely at the top for women. And so what was your support system? How did you create it? How did you find female and male friends? And how did you make time for them? People you could really kind of let your hair down with and be honest with.
Well, you said this, and you're absolutely right. I think we were fortunate at Kraft to have a lot of women who worked in highly professional jobs and leadership jobs. But because I was there for 25 years, I also knew a lot of people over a long period of time. So I was lucky to have a support system with both men and women that I had known for years and have developed friendships with, not over, you know, a couple of years, but a couple of decades. So these were people that I had shared a lot of experiences with. You know, over time, we'd shared a lot of ideas and opinions and values, challenges, and that enabled me to build, you know, with them a sense of mutual trust and respect. So those are the people that when you're having a bad day, you can call. You know they'll pick up the phone, and you'll say, oh, my gosh, I can't believe this is happening. And they'll allow you to vent for a couple of seconds, and then you hang up and you move on. But I don't think I realized at the time how fortunate I was to have people like that that I could call. And it does make a difference because it's someone that even, you know, if it's 30 seconds, you can let your hair down and then hang up the phone and move on. You know, it's a wonderful way to just get something off your chest.
I would say I've also been very lucky to have people like that, both inside the workplace at Unilever and at Kraft, et cetera, and then outside the workplace as well. So I want to ask you a question now that it's a little out there, but, you know, clearly it didn't derail your career. So I'm wondering if you would be willing to share with listeners, what are some of the or one of the most, you know, either embarrassing or outrageous things that happened to you in your career? Because, you know, I think that people really, the more I've kind of probed people, the more I've just heard some of the most amazing things. I'm just curious what yours was.
Wow, what a good question. this probably isn't as colorful as you might like, but it's something that makes me laugh every time I think about it. And it's something that stuck with me and made me think differently every time I have to do what I'm about to tell you about. So you know this very well, Perry. A lot of us went through media training at Kraft. And there were times when I knew I was going to be doing interviews with the press or on a particular show or with a particular publication. And there was someone we brought in who had been a former news anchor in Chicago who was really good at helping prepare you. We went through all of the Q&A. She brings in cameramen to help film you and then to show you how awful you come across. And I remember she said to me something to the effect, Rhonda, you come across like a corporate bureaucrat.
Oh, thank you.
It was mortifying. And it stuck with me. And, you know, after I'd worked with her two or three times, I would joke and I would say, oh, I see your name on my calendar. And I go, okay, get ready to be humbled because you're going to tell me once again, I sound like a corporate bureaucrat. But it was just one of those things. And she was right. I probably did. And it was one of those things, though, that make you see yourself in a different light and recognize that, you know, you have to be very conscious of how you speak and what you say and how you come across, which isn't something I think a lot about. But when people don't know you, it is something very important to think about. So I learned a lot from her, and I'm very grateful for her, you know, helpful criticism. But it really did help me learn over the years.
And you're right. I think media training is grounds for a huge amount of these kinds of moments and stories, and hence why we actually insist on media training. So that's very true. We're getting close to the end here. You obviously have had an amazing career. Looking back, are you happy with how everything turned out? Is there anything you would change? If you could kind of give advice to your younger self, what would you say?
Boy, I feel very fortunate. I wouldn't change anything about my career. I had wonderful jobs along the way. I worked with incredibly wonderful people like you, talented, smart, wonderful people. The one piece of advice I would give is make sure you're broadening your network with people from outside your particular company or organization, and do that as early as you can. When I was president of the cheese division at Kraft, and that was after I'd been at Kraft for a fair amount of time, I was included, because of my position, on the board of several different industry associations with other presidents of, you know, dairy companies from around the country and around the world. At the same time, I joined my first public company board in an industry that wasn't food-related. Both of those experiences were so eye-opening in helping me broaden my perspective as a business leader, because I was able to meet and observe people with quite different approaches to leading and building a business. That wasn't something I had a lot of time to do or had taken the time to do earlier in my career, but it was so valuable. So I would say the earlier in your career you can do that, the more you'll benefit from it.
I think that I was lucky that types of positions that I held in external affairs or corporate affairs, you know, by definition, they are outside looking. So I was always engaged with a wide variety of people. And then, of course, my 15 years in consulting, all of the clients came from different industries, geographies, et cetera. But for people who do come up through a single company, I think it's really important what you say, that they need to be consciously and consistently and proactively out there building networks beyond their immediate organization, particularly today, because even though I'm sad to say it, I think we're going to see many fewer careers where you can really build your entire career through one organization. So it's very important in terms of being able to move to get those growth opportunities that you do have a network.
Right.
So this is your last word. If you could say one thing, tell other women seeking to build the careers and lives of their dreams the way you were able to do for you, what would you tell them?
Well, it's a great question, and I'm going to answer it differently because I don't have one thing, I have two. The first is, know what it is you want. That is so important. And then secondly, don't be shy about asking for help along the way. So back to my first point of knowing what you want, you can't choose a path just because it's the predicted path, or because it's what somebody else thinks you should do, or somebody else has done it because it's right for them. You need to figure out what's right for you, and of course your husband or your family or whomever might be a significant part of your life. But figuring that out isn't always easy, because it's much easier to follow the predicted path and to assume, well, of course that's what I'll do because that's what everybody else does. So put a lot of time and thought into figuring out what it is you want. Then go for it. And to underscore my second point, don't be afraid to ask for help along the way. I never underestimate the people who are willing and happy to help you achieve your goals. I've always been so gratified when I've reached out for help of how people are willing to jump in and say, oh, well, of course I'll make that call, or I can, you know, do this or that for you. People are really wonderful and they do want to help. So don't be afraid to ask for it.
Rhonda, thank you so much for your time. I think you're an inspiration for all of us, and I thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you. You too.
You've been listening to Pivot Points, a series designed to help ambitious women have the careers and lives of their dreams. To hear more interviews, go to www.yourcareeryourterms.com. And be sure to tell us what you think. If there are topics you'd like covered or people you'd like interviewed, please let us know.